Good afternoon. You love to talk to groups like this, but unfortunately it's preaching to the choir. That's why we're all here. You know, the people that should be hearing this aren't. You are. But what is the result of here is for you to go out and call it recruit, call it whatever you need to be, but to get the message out that they're, you know, that our country's in trouble right now. I firmly believe that. I used to live my life and think no matter what happened that tomorrow would be a better day, that that opportunity would be there. I can't say that today. Today I have to say tomorrow could be a worse day. And that's the first time, I'm 61 now, and that's the first time I've ever uttered those words, that tomorrow could be a worse day for the United States of America. I met Governor Johnson, I guess it's 12, 13 years ago, a whole decade ago, probably half of you in the room couldn't even vote back then, I'm guessing that if you're college students. And I was the independent governor of Minnesota. There was one other independent governor who I might add, from all indications, is going to be a senator now, Governor Angus King of Maine, a phenomenal man. He's running in Maine. He went back into the private sector for 10 years, and now he's come out, and he's in, by what I'm hearing in the polls, he's going to win by a landslide. So rest assured there will be an independent voice somewhere in the Senate, and if it's close enough in that Senate, he could be a major power broker. Because if it's one vote that tips either way, whatever way they go, and Angus will be independent, he's a wonderful man. But I met Governor Johnson 12 years ago at what he was then. He was what you would call a moderate Republican. Well, Governor Johnson's no longer a Republican because the Republicans are no longer moderate. Right. Maybe that's the way you put it. And so, of course, for people like Gary and myself, it just took Gary longer to figure out he doesn't belong in these two parties. I learned it 20 years ago or more that I didn't belong with them. I'm fiscally conservative, but I'm socially liberal. That means you don't fit. You don't fit. That means if a smaller government, and it also means if social liberal is, I don't care what people do as long as they don't harm their neighbor. It's up to them. I urge people to vote no on the ballot on both. They want to amend our Constitution to discriminate. And that's purely what it is. It is the most flagrant discrimination you will ever see. And they want the Constitution of Minnesota to okay that. Remember, constitutions are there to protect your rights. They're not there to discriminate and limit your rights, the protection devices. And so again, I urge people, you know, I've been married 37 years now. It doesn't affect my marriage to my wife at all if two gay people want to make the same commitment. It's absurd. It shouldn't be even be on the ballot, and I'll tell you why. It's a civil rights issue. You should have elected officials who have courage, the courage to do the right thing, and it should not be on a ballot for the public to make that decision because you're asking a majority to make a decision that affects a minority. If they allow that, we probably still have slavery. Well, if they allow for people to vote on a majority to vote on a minority issue. But unfortunately, we have to do that because the elected officials don't have the courage to do it themselves, so they figure they'll put it up to the people. And I will tell you something. If the measure against gay marriage here, if it passes and goes on the Constitution, I will have a difficult time living in Minnesota anymore. Because I don't want to live in a state that discriminates to that level. I do not want to do it. I'm having a tough time living here anyway because I hate winter. Yeah, and I live in your home country now, actually a territory of your home country all winter for 4 months a year. I live down now in Baja California, sir. And it's interesting down there because the Mexican people that cross from the Baja to mainland Mexico have to clear customs. Did you know that? they have to do that. They have to clear customs. So it's kind of a territory unto itself, but I love it down there. It's remarkable. But getting back to the message on hand, in light of our Supreme Court's recent decision that I think is going to destroy this country, that corporations have the same rights as individuals and that money is free speech, we need to start working by electing people like Governor Johnson and people of his ilk who will move to, there we need to amend the Constitution. Because the only way that you can overturn a Supreme Court decision is to amend the Constitution. We need to amend it to state corporations do not have the rights of individuals and money is not free speech. I mean, think of this scenario today. A foreign country can decide your next leader here. All they have to do is form a corporation, plus there's no open disclosure. You know, if they're going to put these boatloads of money and buy our elections, they should at least have open disclosure so that we as voters know who's doing the buy-in. They don't even have to do that now. They don't have to disclose anything. I found out that I actually stole this from Gary, unknowingly. I probably heard him say it somewhere and couldn't remember who. But he's given me permission to continue on with the message. I think all presidential candidates should be required to wear NASCAR racing suits. For those of you that ever watch NASCAR, like say the 48 Chev, Jimmy Johnson wins, and he at the end, you notice they got all those patches all over the suit of their sponsors. Well, let's get those for their biggest donors, their biggest bribers. So that we got we can have the ability to make an informed decision. Who owns this Republican or this Democrat? You notice what I call them. Who owns them? And who are they going to pay allegiance to? Who's bought them off? And so it's not a bad idea, you know, even though it gets a chuckle and all that. But getting back, this decision by the Supreme Court is going to be the downfall of our country. Because now a corporation, a foreign country, could form a corporation, they could pump this money in here without any open disclosure and could literally control who your leaders are going to be. Used to be against the law. Corporations couldn't give to political campaigns. Used to be against the law. So you got a lot of work to do. And again, I know I'm preaching to the choir here. That's why you're here. But we've got to go out, we've got to educate people, and we've got to get a new mindset. When you run as a third candidate, mainstream media, they're the culprits too. Because what do they tell when I ran? Well, if you vote for Jesse, Jesse can't win. It's a wasted vote. How many people have heard that? Yeah. Wasted vote. I'd like to change that mindset and reverse it and state that if you vote for a Democrat or Republican, you've wasted your vote. You're going to get the same thing. It does not matter. There will be no change. I just wrote a recent book that where I saw Gary last week that's out there called The Democrats and the Republicans, subtitled No More Games in Government. And I've made the comparison between, and I do apologize to the Crips and Bloods for putting them into that company, but I felt it was needed and I hope they'll understand. But they've even gone so far, they've stolen the gang's colors. Because when you're in a gang, you have what are called colors. I know, I was in one in my youth. I was an outlaw biker. And bikers have colors and wear patches and wear all that. Well, the Crips' colors are blue. What's a blue state? It's a Democratic state. The Bloods' colors are naturally red. What's a red state or a blood-looking state? So they've even stolen their color codes of the street gangs. But let me state this to you unequivocally. The Democrats and the Republicans are even more dangerous than the street gang. And I'll tell you why. The street gangs only affect you if you live in their neighborhoods. Most of us don't. Now, they could affect you. But here's the difference. The Republicans and Democrats affect every person in this whole country. Across the board. Things that they do affect each and every one of us. And it is time to end, as I like to quote my friend Ralph Nader, the two-party dictatorship. because that's what it is. When I taught at Harvard in 2004, I did a class called How Pro Wrestling Prepares You for Politics. And it truly does, because in pro wrestling, Murphy's Law will always be there in a match. Anything that can go wrong will go wrong, so you got to be able to think on your feet. Same as in politics. In pro wrestling, the way you sell yourself and make money is to, at the microphone. In my day, I used to have to piss everybody off so bad they would pay their hard-earned dollars to see me get my butt kicked. That was my job. Well, what's the difference between that and getting someone's money or getting someone's vote? It still requires you to persuade them to do something in your favor. And finally, first and foremost, and probably most important, as I taught at Harvard, is the fact that in pro wrestling, when you see the guy in the ring, he may be nothing like the character he portrays. He could be completely different outside the ring. I mean, I portrayed myself as being, women falling at my feet, this and that and what have you, and here I've been married now 37 years, to one woman. And so what they portray themselves may be nothing like what they're like. And I think that goes on immensely with these Democrats and Republicans. What you see is not what you get with them. It is not what you get with them. So we need to work hard to get Gary Johnson as many votes as he possibly can. Because the more votes Gary gets, the more scare it's going to put into the system. The more frightened the system is going to become. And then, of course, you're going to see them do drastic things. I don't know how many of you are familiar with what happened back in the Perot days. But I'll tell you quickly. Ross Perot in 1992 got 1 out of 5 votes, and he also qualified for $30 million with the program they had for the next election. Well, at that point, the federal debates were under the League of Women Voters, essentially a fairly neutral group. That's why Perot was allowed to debate. Well, Perot scared them so bad in 92, along came 96, and it was Bob Dole and Bill Clinton now. And what happened? Because Perot scared them so bad in 92, the Democrats and Republicans took the federal presidential debates away from the National League of Women Voters, and they formed the Federal Debate Commission, which ironically is headed by two former gang leaders. Two of their gang leaders had it. So now they determine, the two gangs or parties determine who you're going to hear now in 96. So here Perot got 1 out of 5 votes, qualified for $30 million of our tax dollars in the program they had, and you weren't even going to be allowed to hear him because here's what went down in the back room. Dole did not want Perot in the debates because he felt it would erode from his conservative base. Clinton did not want debates at all because he was so far ahead, debates could only bring him down. They cut the deal. And of course, it got rubber stamped by the Federal Debate Commission. You weren't allowed to hear Ross Perot in 96. And normally there's 3 presidential debates and 1 VP debate. 96, that was changed. Remember, Clinton didn't want debates? There was only 2 presidential debates. 1 VP debate, and because they controlled it so much, those 2 presidential debates were held on the same night as the World Series. Now, as good citizens of the country, we should watch the debate, shouldn't we? But we all know, as citizens of the country, given the 2, what do you think the majority of people are going to watch? They're going to watch the World Series. Done by design, people. Done by design. You know, it's interesting. They tell us in the private sector that competition is good. That's the essence of capitalism, right? Is competition drives prices down. The more competitors there are, the better deal it is for us, the people. Yet the hypocrites within our own government, competition is bad. They give you 2. It's very much like walking into the soft drink department at the store. And your only choices are Coke and Pepsi, both colas, one slightly sweeter than the other, depending on your taste buds. That's what we have today. That's their idea of competition. The 2 gangs choose your president, and then you're made to pick from the 2 choices they send forward. Well, in the words of the late, great Jerry Garcia of the Grateful Dead, Jerry said, when made to pick the lesser of two evils, it means you're still picking evil. Think about that. If you're picking the lesser of two evils, you're still picking evil. So, and by the way, you notice I've got James Marshall Hendrix on my chest today. For those of you that don't know him as that, he's Jimi Hendrix, the greatest guitar player to ever walk the planet, and ever will. Jimi Hendrix said something that I think we all need to remember. He said this: when the power of love overtakes the love of power, then we will have peace. I don't think I can say anything better. Let me repeat it again. When the power of love overtakes the love of power, we will then have peace. And ladies and gentlemen, we need peace. I figured it out the other day. I've been on this planet 61 years now, and if you count the war on drugs, which is certainly a war, 20,000 of our Mexican neighbors died last year and the year before because of this idiotic war that the United States can control simply by legalizing. It'll end the murder. We're more afraid of marijuana than we are murder. So if you count the war on drugs and the Cold War, even though for the majority of the Cold War shots weren't fired, how much money was wasted on all the armaments of the two sides of the Cold War for 20 years in these standoffs, if you count them as wars, which I do, we've been at war my entire life virtually. Korea, Vietnam, Grenada, the list on Middle East now, it goes on and on and on. And apparently they want us to believe that the United States can't survive unless we're at perennial war. I'd like to try for once to see if that's true. I'd like for once to see, can we go 15 years of peace? We could have if they hadn't murdered Jack Kennedy. And you notice I said the word they. They murdered Jack Kennedy. Lee Harvey Oswald didn't do it. Trust me on that one. You're too young, but trust me. I've been studying it for 20 years of my life now. So the start is now, and it's at a grassroots level for you to go out, for you to convince people to vote for Gary Johnson. I'm doing it every opportunity I get, and I use my way. You're wasting your vote if you vote for a Democrat or Republican, because you're going to get the same government. You know, Obama ran on change, and I made the statement a week ago, the only change I can tell between him and Bush basically is the color of his skin. The administration works. We're still holding people without trials. Habeas corpus hasn't been given back to us. We're expanding the TSA. They're busting the medical marijuana industry left and right. I'm sorry, I don't see no change. Nothing. The only way to get changes in this country is for us to do it. And the way we do that is to stop electing Democrats and Republicans. It can start at the local level. It can go to the state level. And hopefully someday all the way to the federal level. Governor Johnson's blazing a path. And if we keep the momentum running, he will blaze the path for people that come after him. And that might be. Will attempt and probably are doing whatever they can to take it over. I did one show on conspiracy theory about are we turning into a police state, where we discovered a bill sponsored by Homeland Security that would tell FEMA to build 6 major internment camps throughout America. I went out there to Congress to inquire for whom? Dissidents like me, former governors and mayors, who speak out, against a busted political system that's based completely on bribery. Again, if we bribe, we go to jail. Their whole system's based upon it, bribery. And that show aired one time and then disappeared. True TV won't even acknowledge we did it now. They've taken it off the internet, so somehow they have the power to do that also. I even had Mancow, the disc jockey from Chicago, said he had recorded it, and they wiped it out of his recorded internet. Now, I'm not an expert, because I'm happy to tell you I'm computer illiterate. I'm happy to tell you that I've never owned a cell phone, nor will I ever. Call me a dinosaur, but they ain't tracking Jesse Ventura. When you got all those other things, they can track you. And maybe that's my old military coming out in me again, you know. But again, we're in a critical state, ladies and gentlemen, of what the United States is going to be into the future now and where we've evolved from in the past. And let me finish by saying I encourage everyone. I don't write my books now necessarily for money. I take no upfront money. Sure, if they sell good, I get checks down the line. But I challenge anyone to read my latest book, Democrats and the Bloodlickens, No More Gangs and Government. And if you vote for a Democrat or Republican after reading that book, then you are the problem, you are not the solution. How anyone, did you know 21 of them are convicted felons and we still pay their retirement? Convicted felons. They're all telling you, oh, Obamacare, government-run health care, no good. What hypocrisy, they have five choices of government-run health care. Five of them. Most of us have maybe one, many none. So my belief is that they shouldn't get anything that we get, that we shouldn't get. Why should an elected official get something that we as citizens can't have? Whether you agree with government-run health care or not, if they got it, we should have the option of it. Or take it away from them. One way or the other. Don't let them have anything that you can't have, or vice versa. So I'll finish off today again by stating, I'm worried about this country. I'm worried about the direction it's going, and I'm worried for you, the younger people I see here. By the time a lot of this comes about, I may not be here no more. You know, who knows? It may take a while, but it's moving awful quick. And the choice is yours now. And again, I'm preaching to the choir today. It's up to you to go out and find a choir that doesn't agree and preach to them. That's what's got to have happen. You know, that is what has to happen. And I will proudly, this fall, cast my vote for Governor Gary Johnson for president. I've never voted for a Democrat or a Democrat. And I'm not about to start now. And then as far as, I'll leave you with a little train of thought. I do things differently. Most of you probably don't even realize that when I ran for governor here, I only raised $300,000. I actually made more money doing the job than I spent to get it. I don't think there's an elected official of a major party in the last 50 years that can make that statement. That they, and you know why I did that? My dad. My dad was a World War II vet, 6 bronze battle stars in Europe. And I can also say my mother was a World War II veteran. Not many people can say their mom was. She was a nurse in North Africa. And one day when I was 16 years old, my dad only had an 8th grade education, came here to the Bohemian Flats down by Seven Corners down there where us Slovaks come from. And my dad said to me one day when I came home from school when I was about 16 or 17 in high school, he said, you know, all politicians are crooks. And I looked at my dad and said, come on, Dad, you can't make a blanket statement like that. They can't all be crooks. He said, yes, they can. You want to know why? I said, why? He said, because they pay $1 million for a job that only pays $100,000. Now, in his basic 8th grade education and world, you get what I'm saying. In the private sector, they would lock you up at Bellevue Mental Hospital in New York if you said you were going to go out and spend $1 million for a job that paid you less than you're going to make. Yet that's our political system that we have today. I didn't have to say that. And if my dad, the only thing I regret was my mom and dad were gone when I became governor. And I would have loved for them to be here so I could look at my dad and say, Dad, your son's not a crook. I made more money doing the job than I spent to get it. Why? Because I think we ran a great campaign about ideas instead of money. And so when I say Gary's paving the road, if Jesse decides in 2016, unless Gary wins, then I won't do anything. I'll happily go about my business and enjoy my country going in the right direction. But we all know it's going to be tough for Gary, because what we have to demand is he be allowed in the debates. You can't win unless you're allowed in the debate. They know this. They're not dumb. They know you can't win unless you're allowed to debate. Why do you think they keep him out? Because they don't want to give him any chance to win. Because I proved in Minnesota, I was polling 10% at the primary, and 7 weeks later, I was your governor. Why? I was allowed to debate. I was allowed to debate. So we've got to open these debates up for more ideas, more people, more competition. Because in capitalism, competition is good. Well, if we're a capitalist country, then competition should be good in politics too. More people. But as I said, there's a method to my madness always, and I have to stay loyal to my father. I don't know if it's possible to run for president, make more money doing the job than you spent to get it, but I still despise fundraising. It's legalized panhandling and bribery is all that it is, and our entire system's based on it. So I'm working at a way that if I do it in 2016, I will do it for the least amount of money possible with the biggest impact possible that could take place. And I'll just say that, I'll leave you with this, you can figure out the rest, Howard Stern. Anyway, let me just say that. Sirius Radio doesn't fall on FCC regulations. They can't take Howard off the air. And I'll leave you thinking about that, because the FCC, so get ready, I'm sure they're going to try to take over Sirius Radio. They'll figure out some mechanism to try to take it over and this, that, and whatever. So I'll leave you just with those thoughts. But again, I wholeheartedly, I'm going to take off now. Join me in voting for Gary Johnson, the former New Mexico governor, the former member of the Bloods, who saw the light and is now running independently, or independent as you can be, because the Libertarians stand for independency. So, join me in voting for Gary. Cast your vote loud and proud. Don't be ashamed. Do not be ashamed. Tell them that you vote, that you vote, and you vote proudly for a third person, a third entity, because if we don't get that third entity, I don't know where our country's headed. So again, thank you very, very much. It was my pleasure to be here today, and keep up the good work.